Welcome to Ignite News. I'm Kareem Mosna.
And I'm Sean Marenka. Here's what's happening around Mohawk this week. Canadians were shocked when a gunman shot and killed a Canadian soldier in Ottawa last week. There was an outpouring of support from the community across the country, but nowhere were people more moved than right here in Hamilton. Dyson Wells has more.
Hundreds of Hamiltonians lined up along Main Street between Dundurn and Gage on Friday to honor Corporal Nathan Cirillo's final journey back to his hometown. The 24-year-old Canadian soldier was gunned down 2 days earlier while standing guard at the National War Memorial in Ottawa.
Why are you out here today?
We want to support the troops, support Canada, and support the Cirillo family and all the other Canadian soldiers. And my cousin's also a soldier for the Canadian Armed Forces, and it really hits home when something this tragic happens.
Despite a lengthy wait, the crowd only grew larger as the hours passed.
What was your initial reaction when you found out what happened?
Shocked. Appalled that one of our own soldiers could die on our own soil, on our own land. Angry, but more sad. Now more sad and upset that somebody actually lost their life to almost a coward. I would call him a coward.
Emotions were high as Cirillo's body entered the city. The motorcade was greeted by a careful rendition of O Canada and a hesitant applause. Cirillo's body arrived in Hamilton around 8 o'clock after embarking on a 6-hour journey along the Highway of Heroes, starting off in Ottawa. After the procession, many lined up outside the armory on James Street North to pay their respects.
What did you feel as the car drove by?
But people all over the world are watching this at home on their TVs, and when you're actually here, you know, in person, tears just start coming down my face. It's so much more emotional than I could have ever imagined. Hamiltonians, you know, we all stick together, and we are a strong enough city and country that we will move forward. You know, something like this happens so close to home, although you know it happens all over. It's always different when it's like next door to you. I'm still having trouble with words, and his son, you know, his family, you know, like, I don't think there's a heart that does not go out to his family and his friends, the rest of the soldiers in Quebec. You know, what happened, that tragedy is absolutely devastating.
The funeral for Corporal Cirillo will be held on Tuesday at noon in the Christ Church Cathedral on James Street North. Reporting for Ignite News, I'm Dyson Wells.
A procession of officers and members of the regiment made their way up James Street to Cathedral Place to honor the late Corporal Nathan Cirillo on Tuesday. An armored vehicle towed a gun carriage which carried Cirillo's casket. It came to a stop in front of the Anglican Church, and members of Corporal Cirillo's regiment, the Argyle and Sutherland Highlanders, hoisted the flag-draped casket and marched inside for the funeral. Shortly behind marched a 5-year-old boy wearing Cirillo's Highlander cap, about to say goodbye to his father. In front of the boy was the corporal's mother, Kathy, who was being comforted by two soldiers as they walked her in the cathedral. Paying their respects to the fallen soldier were prominent politicians, including Andrea Horvath, Justin Trudeau, and even Prime Minister Stephen Harper. Outside, thousands of Hamiltonians lined the streets in support, carrying flowers, wearing flags, and pride. An onlooker describes the feeling of unity as a city and a nation.
Sadness, joy that our country could come together for it. So it's just a mix of emotions that every Canadian should be feeling after a situation like this.
Brian McDonald, an elected official in New Brunswick and a 15-year vet in the infantry, says the country has changed because of Cirillo's death.
I mean, these two murders really are a change from what we've had in the past. There haven't been any direct attacks on Canada for, you know, over 100 years. And so I think it does bring it home. I mean, for the Canadian Army, they've kind of been at war and been bearing the brunt of that. But when it actually is on our soil, it's a very different feel.
Nathan Cirillo has been given the fond nickname of Canada's son. For Ignite News, I'm Jennifer Taylor.
Mohawk College recently hosted a leadership conference. The goal was to help students build their skill sets to become effective leaders. Elisa Piccirillo was there and has the story.
In welcoming The Mohawk Students Association and the Learning Support Center put together an all-day event to give students advice on moving forward in their careers and lives. The day began with keynote speaker Tim Wormels, an accomplished entrepreneur, businessman, and the newest Canadian bachelor. Event coordinator and student engagement worker Amy Petch says she thinks students connected with Tim's message.
A lot of people really connected with that message about goals and being open to opportunities and to have a goal, but to be open to whatever it is that comes along your way and to do what you love and see what comes of that.
The afternoon consisted of sessions held by student leaders who talked about how much good body language can help you succeed in the workforce.
Just knowing how to present yourself within any meeting or any professional thing in life that you do, I think is very important, and you can never not know how to do that. It applies to every aspect of your life, whether it's professional or wherever you may be. It's great to know how to do that, especially if you struggle with it.
It doesn't matter who you are or what you do, that you can just pull through anything, even if you're uncomfortable, and show that you are a confident self.
For Ignite News, I'm Elisa Piccirillo.
As your parents probably told you, video games and school don't mix very well. But what if a video game could help you learn valuable real-world skills? Josh Cooper takes a look at a Mohawk professor who is pioneering the use of video games as an educational tool.
Parents often scold their children for playing video games when they should be doing homework. But Professor Sean Isles has reinvigorated his environmental sustainability course through what he calls gamification.
Gamification is taking gaming elements out of their natural state, so a video game or a board game, and applying it to a non-natural environment like business or education.
But how has he gamified environmental sustainability?
Basically, I took leveling and bonuses and kind of the work at your own. Work at your own pace that you get in a video game, where you can go as fast as you want, but only as slow as the game will let you. Those elements I took from the games, place it in my course, so students can work through the course as fast as they want, but only as slow as the learning plan. You get challenges like bosses in a video game, which lead you to bonuses and extra content and things like that. So.
But why video games?
I think it just makes it a little bit more fun for the students. The way that the content rolls out is a little bit easier, and the fact that you can get bonuses and have some fun in a classroom kind of changes that, the view of education.
And how have his students responded to this new approach?
I think they like the elements of gamification. The feedback that I've got has been pretty positive overall. They like how the course rolls out. They only get, they get one level at a time, so they don't see 14 modules of material. They see one at a time, and as they finish that module, they move on, they get the next module once they beat the boss or the challenge at the end of the module. So I think they're having a good time, and they like it. There's a little bit of a learning curve at the beginning, learning how things roll out and how it works, but overall it's good.
Ken Wong is a graphic designer with IdealWorks who helped design the gamification course.
It was my job to basically make sure that the game looked appealing, was functional, and students would be able to engage with it in a very intuitive way.
But where did he begin?
So when Sean came to us with his idea, immediately we knew that this was going to be a top-down kind of look, and it was going to be people dragging and dropping pieces like buildings and whatnot. So the game was already kind of, visually it was already kind of laid out in my head. And basically all I did was I took my knowledge of 3D and started building up little assets and then basically hand them off to Garrett and Vuk, who are the developers on the project. And that's how we were able to make it, and that's how I started, I guess.
Wong says Isles is the key to improvements to the game.
The feedback we receive would most likely be through Sean. Actually, it is through Sean. So if we hear anything about it, good, bad, or whatnot, it is through Sean, because he interacts with the students more so. We are a support resource for the college, and we have obviously our own things that we have going on in here. But that is how we find out what's happening.
Where does Wong see this heading in the future?
The game is a standalone game right now. But it would be great to be able to create an online world where other people could play it and whatnot, interact with each other. That would be a second phase, but once again, that's dependent upon resources and whatnot down the road.
Reporting for Ignite News, I'm Joshua Cooper.
Hamilton will host some of Canada's top blues performers this weekend. Josh Cooper spoke with the organizers.
Life can be tough in a city built on the steel industry. One minute you're rolling in money, and the next you're out on the street looking for a new job. Sometimes music is the key to relieving your day-to-day stress.
We have plenty of blues artists in this town, great venues that are happening around here in the Niagara Peninsula, and it was just the natural. Plus, for me, I've always liked the blues, so that's why I started the blues radio show.
Wallace hosts Blues Blast on the Mohawk College radio station 101.5 The Hawk. And it's through his show that he met local blues musician John Crawford.
Through the radio show, we connected with the Hamilton Blues Society and its president, John Crawford. And we've been talking for the last year or so that one of the things that the Hamilton area needed was a blues award show. So what we've started to do is we're working towards sponsoring a blues awards for local artists from Hamilton, the Niagara Peninsula, and the surrounding area.
Crawford, who goes by the stage name Big Johnny Blue, thanks to fellow Hamilton singer Ginger St. James, points to Hamilton's blue-collar origins as his main reason for spearheading the festival.
Hamilton is a natural place for blues because it's a working man's city. And we have all the manufacturing, the steel factories. It's just a hard-working town, and blues naturally goes with that.
Wallace also points out that the festival will not only benefit the Hamilton blues community, but the Mohawk College community as well.
I might add also that this concept of doing a blues award show will involve a lot of our students, from the photography students to our television students, and we're hoping to have it a cooperative effort between Mohawk College and the Hamilton Blues Society.
Crawford said he hopes the festival will help the local community discover Hamilton's unique brand of blues.
We reach out to the community to show them about blues music, educate them about the history of the blues music in Hamilton, let them know that Hamilton has it's like almost like a subgenre of blues in the blues world, and we call it hammer blues. And it shows the attitudes, the feelings, all of the things that make Hamilton a natural town to be in for blues.
Hammer Blues Fest will take place on Saturday, November 1st at the Knights of Columbus Hall on Queenston Road. The show starts at 2 o'clock and will feature numerous Hamilton bands, including Harp Dog Brown, Jack DeKaiser, and Alfie Smith. Reporting for Ignite News, I'm Joshua Cooper.
Hamilton music fans have been absolutely spoiled this month. With the Blues Fest coming up this weekend, Hamiltonians are still grooving to the smooth sounds of Jazz Fest from last week. Nick Hine-Natt was there to check it out.
Chris Ferguson has plenty to be happy about. In his second year as a festival organizer, he has hit the nail on the head and made sure to secure his Steel City Jazz Fest as a stalwart in Hamilton's music scene.
The biggest crowd so far was at last night's show for the Jazz Connection Big Band, and we had about 100 people out, and Artwood Art Bar can't even hold 100 people, so we definitely couldn't have had that many people out the other nights. And it was a ton of fun. It was a really great show.
After nearly two full weeks of shows split between Christ Church Cathedral, Artwood Art Bar, and the Pearl Company, with close to 500 attendees and over 15 acts, what was a small homegrown effort turned out to be an extremely successful and well-attended event in the city that already has people talking about next year.
I think it's awesome. Hamilton has a huge music culture, even though it's kind of a smaller town, and I think it's great that we're still a part of the bigger scene, kind of competing with Toronto, and it still brings it and keeps it home, which is awesome.
Packed house after packed house proved that Hamilton is ready to make a statement in the Canadian jazz festival scene. Based on this year's turnout, it looks as though more artists from broader regions will be vying for a spot in next year's festival, as the response was overwhelmingly positive. For Ignite News, I'm Nick Hine-Natt.
That's all in news for this week. Here's Rebecca Anderson with your entertainment update.
If you're looking to learn a little history from your video games, you might want to think about checking out the new Rise, Son of Rome. But be warned, our game reviewer, Steven Sobot, says you won't learn a lot from this game.
Legionaries! Salute your new centurion!
In the last few game reviews I've done, I've noticed most of them are based on surviving in a wild and uncontrollable location. Fighting and combat are secondary to survival. Maybe it's because I'm a sucker for atmosphere, or maybe I'm the kind of gamer who puts story ahead of gameplay. Or maybe I'm just bad at fast-paced games. Well, screw that. I want blood and gore and gratuitous violence. Rise Son of Rome is a hack-o-slash-o, button-mash-o game developed by Crytek where you play as Marius Titus, a Roman general who is defending Rome from invading barbarians. You go to the Emperor Nero's royal palace to protect them from the invaders and the immortal mythical general Damocles. As you're protecting Nero in the royal vaults, you begin to tell him the story of how you became a Roman general. Basically, your premise is your family was brutally murdered by barbarians and you want blood. I mean, it's not like your father minutes ago said,
"You may have mastered the sword, but never rush to meet the world with it drawn."
Oh, wait, scratch that, because after your mother and sister are killed, your dad goes into a blood frenzy. So much for peaceful resolutions. Anyway, you are transferred to the British Isles, where out of desperation, you take command and lead the legionaries to victory. Obviously. What, did you think you...
If you're looking for something light and frothy in the new TV season, the Cristela TV series could be your cup of tea. Kyle Williamson has this recommendation.
I'll drag it out a bit more.
No one knows.
The Cristela?
Ah, my beautiful wife. Her beautiful mother. And Cristela.
There will be at least one show on TV this fall that will make you laugh. Cristela is the new comedy series to watch this fall. Cristela is pretty much George Lopez, except the main character Cristela is a law intern. The show is about a Mexican-American who lives with her sister's family and her mother. There's even an overweight, funny family friend who is always over at the house. The show's pilot heavily relied on ethnic humor, playing up on the fact that Cristela and her family are Latino. While the jokes are funny, many are jokes you've probably heard before.
Oh, can I toss this in before you empty that?
Is this really happening?
Oh my God. Oh my God, I am so sorry. Obviously you're not the cleaning crew. Can you validate me?
I think you've been validated enough.
You can forgive the lack of originality in the show's concept because it does its job. It makes you laugh. There seems to be enough of a storyline to keep Cristela interesting. First, there are enough family members living under one roof to provide plenty of witty, banter-filled episodes. Plus, there's Cristela's other world, her new internship. The law office where Cristela works is bound to be filled with racial, almost cringe-worthy humor. This is thanks to Cristela's stereotypical, racist Texan boss, played by Sam McMurray.
They say when a person's drowning, the third time he goes under, it's for good.
I never learned to swim, so for me it'd be like first time, ploop, dead.
Can't swim? Mm-hmm. How'd you get to Texas?
The show doesn't need big names to be a success. The group of actors seems natural together, and the chemistry works. The lines and jabs at one another seem effortless, like the cast is a group of old friends.
Point to the biggest house and say you're American. You work hard, you make something of yourself, and one day you can clean that house.
The show can expect some backlash over its highly stereotypical and racial approach to humor.
A Jew, a Mexican, and a blonde walk into a law office.
Wait, and then what happens?
Still, Cristela will have you laughing for half an hour every Friday night. For me, that earns this show a rating of 4 out of 5. You can catch Cristela Friday nights at 8:30 on CHCH. For Ignite Entertainment, I'm Kyle Williamson.
Canada has a long history of superheroes. There's Wolverine and Alpha Flight, but the most iconic Canadian superhero has to be Captain Canuck. And as Alex Smith found out recently, the captain has a secret connection to Mohawk College.
Is he
The lines were long at Hamilton Comic Con as fans eagerly awaited to meet Captain Canuck, the iconic Canadian superhero.
Captain Canuck was created by Richard Comley in 1976. Issue number one came out, and Captain Canuck Incorporated formed approximately 3 years ago and revitalized the captain with this, as you see right now. There's an animated web series that's out. There's a comic book coming out next March.
In a small way, Mohawk College played a part in that. In 2006, I was asked to participate in creating a course, a one-year postgraduate course for comic book illustration and scripting. I taught the 2007 for that course. And prior to that, I taught, there was times when I was teaching three times a week for a continuing ed course in drawing and illustration, and always treated my students well with free comics, free Captain Canuck comics. And those days I had lots to give away. Not anymore. They're pretty well all gone. So now they're getting to be more expensive collector's items. So next year is our 40th anniversary. We have a lot of stuff happening next year. A new miniseries, another summer special. Interesting thing about this issue is very first time a governor general has ever written a letter for a comic book series in history included in this particular issue.
Well, it's iconic. It's, you know, it's probably the only real Canadian superhero that you really identify, you know, with the Canadian flags all over him. Like, you can't mistake him for anything else, and there's no other superhero using the Canadian flag. I mean, we like to have great ties with comic book and comic strip, book illustrate. All these things are great sources of creativity that animation, I mean, TV series, feature films, and it's amazing feature films how they've taken every comic book idea and put it on the film.
And Captain Canuck is certainly no exception to the current trend.
And lots of other things. There's still a feature film in the works. Second draft of the screenplay has been completed, so that's moving ahead.
And while the film is in the works, it was important to the creators to keep everything truly Canadian.
It's a nice, great collaboration of a lot of great Canadian artists, creative talent, writers that are coming together now, doing the web series, doing the animated series, and animated feature coming up soon.
The future is certainly shining bright for this Canadian hero. For Ignite News, I'm Alex Smythe.
Now let's head back to the news desk with Sean and Kareem.
Thanks, Rebecca. Mohawk sports fans are working overtime right now with the volleyball and basketball seasons just kicking off. And as Sam McFadden reports, the women's volleyball team is starting to turn heads.
The Mohawk women's varsity volleyball team traveled to London on Saturday to go head-to-head against the Fanshawe Falcons. The women were looking to redeem themselves after falling three sets to St. Clair on Friday. Mohawk came on strong in the first match, taking an early lead against Fanshawe. The Falcons tried to come back late in the first set, but Mohawk stayed strong and took the win 25-23. In the second set, Mohawk pulled ahead, dominating Fanshawe in the serving and tough blocks. The Falcons battled hard but were no match for Mohawk. The Mountaineers ran away with a 25-15 victory. The third match was tougher for the Mountaineers, as the play was more evenly matched. For the first time in the set, the women found themselves playing from behind. But Mohawk battled their way back and took the win 25-18. Head coach Andy Nicholson says his team was finally able to stay positive and bounce back after Friday night's loss.
It was a good game. We set a good game plan, and compared to last night when we lost, today we followed our game plan. The girls were excited. We got rid of a lot of the negativity that was in our body language last night, and again did a lot of good things today. Consistency. The big thing that we have to work on is understanding that to be successful in this league, you have to built, set a platform, build on the platform, and right now the platform is based on consistency. So consistency in passing, consistency in serving, and understanding what the other team is trying to do against you. First time we've beaten Fanshawe in 4 years, so this is the fourth year I've been at Mohawk, and we haven't beat them until today. Really proud of the girls again. It was a very solid effort based on the game plan, and it was fantastic, I think. Well, we set our goal is for the playoffs. This is again the fourth year I've been there. We haven't made the playoffs yet. We've got a really solid group of athletes this year. Good balance in our attack. So we have that goal of playoffs is achievable, and we're going to make it. Again, it's about consistency. Today the girls were talking in the debrief about setting a platform. We had a great platform today as far as this is a good starting point for us. And now we're going to build on our attack and build on our passing and build on our serving. And this is a starting point.
Left side Chantel Baker says her team was finally able to come together.
Today was a great game. Everyone worked together. That's really what we need to do to win this season. We didn't let it go to five. We stuck it straight out and won in three. So I thought it was great. Probably the fundamentals, like just watching passes and watching the ball into our arms for passes and easy stuff like that. We followed Andy's game plan, so we have that down, but just really the fundamentals. Probably following the game plan a little better. Like Andy, like I said, works really hard on making a game plan, watching the film, all of that. So I think personally, I just need to remember the game plan the whole game and stick with it. Well, we kept our positivity up this game. So I think as a team, we just need to keep our positivity up. Even if we lose a point, just work on the next one and not let it get to us at all. My personal goals are, like I said, stick to the game plan every time. So I think that's really about it. Get my kills up.
The women will travel to Niagara on Friday, October 31st, with the hopes of bringing home their second win of the season. For Ignite Sports, I'm Sam McFadden.
That's your Ignite News for this week. Like Ignite News on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at Ignite Online. I'm Kareem Mosna.
And I'm Sean Marenka. Thanks for watching, Mohawk.